Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Today we are going to discuss the refractive errors. It is an important topic related to ophthalmology because most of the patients that presents to the IOPD are suffering from refractive errors. Before discussing the refractive errors, let's discuss the basic first. What is refraction? Whenever a light enters from a rarer medium to a denser medium, it bends towards the normal. So here you can see the rare medium is the air and the denser medium is the glass, and it bends towards the normal. And if you see in this picture, the straw looks broken. Now, this is a phenomena which works in the eye. There are two types of lenses. One is converging lens, also known as convex lens. It's positive in a sense that it magnifies the image. And then there is another lens which is a concave lens. It is also known as diverging lens, and it is a negative lens. If you consider eye as a camera, the eyelids work as a shutter. Cornea and lens act as a focusing system. Iris acts as a diaphragm. Choroid acts as a dark room chamber. And the retina is a light sensitive film on which the image is formed. Now, what is emetropia? Emetropia is a condition in which there is no refractive error present in the eye. Now, there are three factors which are responsible for an emetropia: the power of the cornea, the power of the lens, and the axial length. What is the axial length? It is the distance from the corneal surface to the retina. Usually it is 24 to 25 millimeter. And what is the total power of the eye? It is almost 59 diopters, out of which 75% belongs to the cornea. Means out of 59 diopters, almost 43 diopters is that of cornea. And remaining 15 to 16 diopters is of the crystalline lens. This is being assumed when the accommodation is at rest. What is accommodation? Accommodation is a phenomena when person looked at a near object, the anteroposterior diameter of the lens increases due to constriction of the ciliary body. As a result, the anteroposterior diameter of the lens is increased, ultimately increasing the power of the lens, which usually is 59 diopters. What is ametropia? Ametropia means that the refractive error is present in that patient. It can be classified into four types. Number one, myopia, which is also known as near-sightedness. Near means any near target. Sightedness means to see. Means a myopic patient will be able to see the things at near. Then comes the hypermetropia, which means far-sightedness. This is slightly confusing because in the case of hypermetropia, the patient will be able to see far subject better as compared to near objects. But the far vision is also not 100%. Then comes the astigmatism. It is the refractive error in which the curvature of the cornea or lens is not spherical and therefore causes an image to blur on the retina due to formation of two focal points. Usually we assume that the image formed by the cornea as well as lens formed a single focal point. But in cases of astigmatism, image is formed on two points. What is presbyopia? Presbyopia is loss of accommodative ability of the lens, resulting in difficulty with the near task. The accommodative power is most during the early phase of the life up to the age of 15 years, which start decreasing slowly, and ultimately at the age of 40 years it is so much decreased that a person require aid for a near work. Now comes the hypermetropia. It is a refractive error in which the parallel rays of light coming from the infinity are focused behind the retina and the image is blurred, as you can see in this picture. Now, coming to the etiology, remembering those three factors that we have discussed before, if the axial length is decreased, that means the hyperopia or hypermetropia will be classified as axial hypermetropia. If the surface of the cornea is flat, that will be labeled as curvature hypermetropia. Any alteration in the refractive index of the lens will lead to index hypermetropia. Positional hypermetropia. Now, in this case, if the lens is slightly posterior to its normal position, it will induce an hypermetropia. And then comes the aphakia. Aphakia means absence of the lens. So if we assume that the lens is absent in the eye, means out of 59 diopters, almost 15 to 16 diopters decreases. That will lead to aphakic hypermetropia. That usually occurs after surgery or after a blunt trauma, which leads to the dislocation of the crystalline lens. Now, what is total hypermetropia? It is the amount of refractive error estimated after complete cycloplegia with a drug like atropine or cyclopen. Now, we have discussed the accommodation before. Accommodation is the phenomena which gives the ciliary body its tone. As I said before the age of 15 years, accommodation is at its peak, which decreases with age. What happens is, if a child present to you with a certain refractive error, you may not be sure because he or she may be using his accommodative power. So to calculate exact amount of total hypermetropia, you have to cause the paralysis of the ciliary body to see the total hypermetropia, because by paralyzing you will take the accommodation out of the equation. So it can be classified into latent hypermetropia and manifest. Latent means hidden, manifest which can be seen. Latent hypermetropia is corrected by an inherited tone of ciliary muscle, as I told you before. It is usually of 1 diopter and high in children, specifically before the age of 15 years, and along with the increase in age, it decreases. It is revealed after abolishing the tone of ciliary muscle using the cycloplegic drugs. Then comes the manifest hypermetropia. It is the remaining part of total hypermetropia. It can be further classified into facultative hypermetropia and absolute hypermetropia. Facultative hypermetropia is that hypermetropia which is corrected by the patient's accommodation. Then comes the absolute hypermetropia. This is the residual part of hypermetropia that cannot be corrected by the patient's accommodative efforts. So if we summarize this, the total hypermetropia consists of manifest as well as latent hypermetropia. The manifest is further divided into facultative hypermetropia and absolute hypermetropia. It is the absolute hypermetropia that we have to treat. Sometimes in a hypermetropic patient, usually the glasses are prescribed after cycloplegic refraction. Symptoms are those complaints with which a patient can present to you. The principal symptom is the blurring of vision for close work. It may, depending upon the age of the patient and degree of refractive error. Sometimes the patient are asymptomatic. Astenopic symptoms means the patient may present with the history of headache. He may not complain of decreased vision, but he may suggest that whenever he or she start doing a near work, he feels a headache or discomfort. It can be accompanied with decreased vision, or a patient may also present with only the complaint of decreased vision. In children under 15 years of age, if they are using accommodation, it may lead to a convergent squint. What are the signs? When you examine the patient, the visual acuity is decreased. The eyeball may be small or normal in size. Cornea may be smaller than normal. If the cornea is plain and its power is less than 40 diopters, it may be labeled as cornea plana. Anterior chamber may be shallow in case of smaller axial length. Lens can be dislocated backwards. Then comes an investigation, A scan ultrasonography. It is a method used to check axial length of the eyeball, and it may reveal short axial length. At birth, usually 2 to 3 diopter hypermetropia is present, which is normal, and it usually decreases by the age of 5 to 10 years. Now, a complication known as myopia can develop. Usually it occurs in high hypermetropia and unilateral hypermetropia. It is also known as lazy eye. Treatment involves surgical and non-surgical. Non-surgical are spectacles, and it is corrected with the help of convex lens. Then comes the contact lens. Surgical includes photorefractive keratectomy, laser in situ keratomeliosis, LASIK, and conductive keratoplasty. These are the surgical methods that are usually done on cornea. What is the difference between photorefractive keratectomy versus LASIK? First, remember that the laser used for this surgery, in fact in both surgeries, is excimer laser. The mode of applying that laser is slightly different. If you look closely, In PRK, it is a simple procedure in which the corneal epithelium is removed. The examiner laser is applied to flatten the corneal surface, and then at the last, the PCL is applied and we wait for the healing. But in LASIK, it is a slightly modified procedure in which we remove the flap of the cornea with some part of stroma. We apply the laser and replace the flap in its position, which leads to less pain, less discomfort, and earlier healing. In children younger than 6 years, some hypermetropia is physiological, as I told you before, and for which there is no correction required. Treatment is required if there is a squint. Usually with age, the refractive error tends to change, so it is recommended that a child suffering from hypermetropia should be evaluated after every 6 months. Now comes the myopia. It is the most common refractive error, in which parallel rays of light entering the eye are focused in front of retina. It is also labeled as nearsightedness because a patient suffering from myopia will be able to see near things clearly. Similar to hypermetropia, myopia is also classified according to the axial length, curvature of the cornea, lenticular power, and position. Myopia can be due to excessive accommodation as well. For this reason, the children are advised not to use the gadgets like mobile, tablets, because it may induce myopia in them. What are the clinical types of myopia? This includes congenital, simple or developmental, degenerative or pathological, and acquired. Congenital myopia is present in premature babies with some other birth defects as well. Usually the refractive error is of 8 to 10 diopters and its stationary means. It will not increase with age. It may be associated with increase in axial length, esotropia, or other eye abnormalities. Then comes the simple myopia. Simple myopia is a physiological or school-going myopia. It is of the commonest type, results due to normal biological variations in the development of the eye. The starting point of this type of myopia is around 7 years, and it is of moderate severity, means that the refractive error seldomly exceeds 8 diopters, and there are no degenerative changes in the retina. Then comes the pathological myopia. As the name suggests, it is more progressive in nature and is related to heredity linked growth of the retina. The age of onset is in early adult life, and it is severe because the refractive error in these cases are more than 6 diopters. What is the pathophysiology? There are some genetic factors that lead to more growth of the retina and stretching of the sclera, which increases the axial length, ultimately leading to degeneration of the choroid, degeneration of the retina, and degeneration of the vitreous. These all things lead to decreased VN. So what are the signs that you will see in the case of pathological myopia? This picture is of a fundoscopy. Here you can see, along with these vessels, you can see some choroidal vessels as well, because the retina is so thin due to stretching. But the important point to show is the crescent. This is the crescent. Crescent is just like a moon. It occurs due to overstretching of the cornea, and this area is devoid of the retina. This occurs due to overstretching of the retina, and this area is devoid of the retina, and you can see the underneath sclera through this. This is known as myopic crescent. In case of extreme stretching, the Bruch's membrane suffers and leads to breaks in the Bruch's membrane. This is an important anatomical landmark. As it breaks, the choroidal vasculature will ultimately approach the retina, which is not good for the retinal health. When the choroidal circulation reaches the retina, it is known as subretinal neovascularization, and it is harmful for the VN. Foster Fuchs spots are the pigmentary retinopathy that is also an hallmark of degenerative myopia. Then there is posterior stephaloma. Stephaloma is an abnormal protrusion of the uveal tissue through a weak point in the eyeball. As these structures stretches, there are chances that they will produce a weakness, and ultimately the intraocular contents start pushing outward from that point and leads to stephaloma formation. Stephaloma itself is of five types, but in this case, usually the posterior stephaloma occurs as shown in this picture. Complications that can occur in an degenerative myopia include macular hemorrhage, hemorrhage at the macular site, retinal tears due to excessive stretching and ultimately leading to retinal detachment, vitreous hemorrhage, choroidal hemorrhage, complicated cataract can occur. What is cataract? Cataract is the opacity in the lens. Nicolar sclerosis is a subtype of cataract, and the most common of glaucoma that can occur in myopia is primary open angle glaucoma. Symptoms, the patient will present with blurred vision, half shutting of the eyes. This means the patient says that they see better when they do so. Astronomic symptoms, which include headache, and in the cases of myopia, divergent squint may be present, while in hypermetropia, I've told you the chances of convergent squint are more. Convergent means the eyeballs are diverted towards the nose, inner side, and divergent squint means away from the nose. Signs include prominent eyeballs as the axial length is large cornea, anterior chamber is deep due to increased axial length, large and sluggishly reacting pupil, fundus examination changes are usually seen only in the degenerative or pathological myopia, and a scan will show increased axial length. Non-surgical treatment includes concave lens and contact lens. Surgical options include radial keratotomy. Laser-based procedures which are done by examiner include PRK, LASIK and LASIK. These are the procedures which are done on cornea. Then comes the clear lens extraction and phakic posterior chamber implant. So you cannot change the axial length, but the other two factors can be altered. But among those two, only cornea is preferred because it almost contributes 75% of power of the eye. What is astigmatism? It is a defect of an optical system in which the light rays do not fall on a single point and forms two different images, leading to the formation of Sturm's conoid. What are its types? It can be divided into regular or irregular astigmatism. Regular is the change in the refractive power, which is uniform from one meridian to another. It is further classified into with the rule and against the rule astigmatism. And then there is irregular astigmatism, which is irregular change of the refractive power in different meridians. So if we differentiate with the rule or against the rule, with the rule means that the vertical power of the cornea is slightly more than the horizontal power of the cornea. Usually this is present in more than 90% of the population. In against the rule astigmatism, usually the horizontal power of the cornea is more as compared to the vertical one. Now what are the types of regular astigmatism? It can be simple astigmatism, it can be compound, and it can be mixed. Now, as we have discussed that there are two focal points present in astigmatism. Now, if one of the focal point focuses on the retina, means is emmetrope, and the other forms in front of the retina, that means simple myopic astigmatism. And the other way around, it will be simple hyperopic astigmatism. But the condition in which one focal point is in front of the retina and the other is at the back of the retina, that is mixed astigmatism. Then comes the compound. If both of the focal points are in front of the retina, that is a compound myopic astigmatism. And if both of them lies behind the retina, that is compound hyperopic astigmatism. The most common etiology is corneal. Then comes the lenticular, which is very rare. And last but not least is retinal, which is very, very rare. Symptoms include blurring of vision and synoptic symptoms and pinhole effect. Pinhole is a phenomena which in a patient with refractive error, if you put a pinhole in front of the patient eyes, the vision will improve. So what the patient will do is he will create this phenomena by himself by closing half of the eyes. This will result in a pinhole effect and ultimately patient will see better. And usually patient will say to you that whenever he or she half close the eye, they will see better. Amblyopia may be present in such cases. Investigations include retinoscopy, keratometry, and astigmatic fan test. Retinoscopy, most of you confuse it with ophthalmoscopy. Always remember that retinoscopy is only reserved for refractive errors. Keratometry is a method by which we calculate the power of the cornea. Now comes the treatment. The non-surgical treatment includes spectacles, which includes surgical lenses, and hard contact lenses are used for all types of astigmatism. Surgical treatment include limbal relaxing incision, extra sutures, photorefractive keratectomy, LASIK and LASIK. All of these procedures are being done on the cornea. Now comes the presbyopia. It is the physiological loss of accommodation in the eyes in the advancing age, usually occur after the age of 40 years. In this picture, you can see there is a less flexible lens, and when a person looks at a near target, the image usually not focused on the retina. It is believed that it usually occurs secondary to the deposition of insoluble proteins, which results in decrease in elasticity of the lens. Around 45 years of age, the accommodation become less than 3 diopters, and the reading is only possible at 40 to 50 centimeter. That's why the patient present with complaint of difficulty in reading fine prints, headache and pupil fatigue. This is the chart which shows that with age, how the near point of accommodation changes. At 10 years, a child can see from 7 cm distance. But at the age of 50 years, almost, it goes up to 40 cm. Symptoms include blurred near vision, and patient try to compensate that to move the near target slightly away, which will make the image more clearer. Patient may also present with the complaint of headache, fatigue, and symptoms are worse in the dim light. The treatment is usually done with spectacles in the form of convex lens, and it is only recommended for the near work. Anisometropia. If the refractive state of both eyes are equal, it is known as isometropia. But if the eyes have unequal refraction and there is a difference of refractive error in both eyes, it is called anisometropia. The refractive correction often leads to different image sizes on the two retinas. That is known as anisochonia, but usually it occurs when the refractive error is quite high, or you can say that the difference between the refractive error of two eyes is large. Treatment is done with spectacles or contact lens.